ओके सर।
सो गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल। आई एम डॉक्टर एस के घुमरे, हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट एंड असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर फ्रॉम आईसीएस कॉलेज ऑफ आर्ट्स कॉमर्स एंड साइंस खेड। टुडे इज माय टॉपिक ऑफ लेक्चर इज ग्रीन केमिस्ट्री अप्रोच थ्रू ऑर्गेनिक केमिस्ट्री। So, one must aware with concept of green chemistry, as green chemistry focus on to minimize or eliminate the use or generation of hazardous substances during organic synthesis. Green chemistry is defined as the utilization of set of principle that reduces or eliminates the use or generation of hazardous substances in design, manufacture, and application of chemical products. So Paul Anastas, who is the director of Center for Green Chemistry and Green Engineering at Yale University at DC Washington. Paul is regarded as father of green chemistry after publishing Green Chemistry Theory in Practice. There are so many non-biodegradable, such as CFC, which cause the ozone depletion. One of the non-biodegradable, such as DDT, which is almost banned, and other hazardous substances from the industry, such as release of oxides of nitrogen and sulfur. We know that which cause the acid rain. One of the global warming. Reason that is the unchecked burning of fossil fuel, that is release of CO2. So one of the chemical accidental tragedy in 1884 in the Bhopal, that is the explosion of methyl isocyanate escaped into the atmosphere and caused the tremendous loss of human lives. The survival still suffering long-term effect of methyl isocyanate. So we need have solution on all these aspects. So hence, green chemistry concept aim to eliminate or at least reduce the environmental pollution by use of synthetic methodologies, which helps in keeping the environment clean and green. So all of the technological miracle that chemistry produced really produced a modern life. Then we look other side of equation, we get unintended consequences of pollution and its effect on the environment and on human health. So green chemistry is really a way of keeping all those innovations without all of these unintended consequences. So green chemistry made a solution on these unintended consequences. One of the goal of green chemistry is to convert waste to resource. Some of the element in the periodic table, so for example, that is hafnium, silver, gold, zinc, gallium, indium, thallium, arsenic, antimony get exhausted within next 5 to 50 years. So supply of chemical is running out. So what is needed is to recover and reuse these methods. So depletion of resources at alarming rate. So the recapture of metal is highly desired. Waste we need to recognize in a man-made concept. In nature, there is no waste. Every time a waste is generated, an organism evolves to use that waste as a feedstock. And so we think about how to do the same thing in industry. How you prevent or avoid the waste or utilize whatever in a valuable way. So many companies are using green chemistry as a part of their business model, as a part of their strategic planning. There is some of our highest volume chemicals, and there are also some of the most highly regulated because of their historic hazards to human and environment. But yet green chemistry is showing how you can cause use of new solvent. Sometimes they are bio-based solvents. Sometimes you can use water for things that we never thought you could use water for before as a solvent. And what really interesting, there is even ways of using carbon dioxide and putting it in a liquid form in order to use that is solvent. So it's non-toxic, it's cheap, and does not have all of the same problem of those traditional chlorinated organic solvent. We have forced chemical to do things they did not naturally want to do. So we have heated them, we have kept under pressure, we have tortured them to obey and become the things we want them to become. But it is not just quantities of energy that's important. It is the character and nature of energy that we use it need to be renewable and non-depleting, non-toxic and non-polluting. So whatever we get facility in day-to-day life, but during the chemical process, we get the byproducts, and there is need to check on that byproduct through the green chemistry approach. Now, the green chemistry is based on its 12 principle. So first principle is what? It is better to prevent waste than to treat and clean up waste after it is formed. So there is a famous quote in the medical field that is, prevention is better than cure. So more waste as a byproduct, more chemical processes needed to separate it and to purify that product. So it causes more pollution. So whatever the steps increases in the purification, so what it releases the waste, and that much pollution will increase. So next principle, that is, synthetic method should be designed to maximize the incorporation of all materials used in the process into the final product. This strategy of synthesis results into less or no byproduct, no waste, so no pollution. So we have to make the strategy so in our reaction there is very less product so as to get less or no product so as to get no less or no waste and results no pollution. Now the third principle of green chemistry, wherever practicable, synthetic methodologies should be designed to generate substance that possess little or no toxicity to human health and environment. So, next principle, that is, chemical product should be designed to preserve efficacy of function while reducing toxicity. This approach is applicable to pharmaceutical drugs molecule, which enhance or preserve their biological efficacy, and at the same time there should be lowering of their toxicity. So whenever there is design of new organic molecule, new drug, so we have to keep in mind to preserve their biological activity with lowering their toxicity. Next principle, that is, the use of auxiliary substance, that is solvents, should be made unnecessary whenever possible. So while we are doing the organic synthesis, we have to synthesize the reaction in the solid medium, so whenever possible, to develop solvent-free synthesis. next principle, that is energy requirement should be recognized for their environmental economic impact and should be minimized. So we have to develop synthetic methods at ambient temperature and pressure, that is at 298 Kelvin and 1 atmospheric pressure. So we, in normal way, we supply the energy to reaction by heating on account of electricity or gas consumption. So try to minimize or avoid it wherever possible. So whenever we are going to the synthesis, so we have to keep in mind that is consumption of electricity or gas should be minimum. So one of the solution for this is the microwave synthesis. The next principle, a raw material or feedstock should be renewable rather than depleting wherever possible. For example, synthesis of adipic acid from glucose, not from benzene, as benzene is petroleum product and required millions of years for its synthesis. Next principle, unnecessary derivatization should be avoided whenever possible. Avoid the protection, deprotection, temporary modification of physical and chemical processes because it adds extra step in reaction to reach the final product. Next principle, that is catalytic reagent are superior to the stoichiometric reagent. Here we understand it by the example, whenever we convert acetophenol into its secondary alcohol. So we have two ways. By one way, we use the sodium borohydride. And for this reaction, we get the byproduct as the boron trihydride and NaOH. In another way, we can use the same reaction. We can do the same reaction by using H2 and palladium C. So we get the only one product and there is no byproduct. We get our desirable product and no byproduct. So we have to use the catalytic reagent. So there is no byproduct and reaction yield will be high and no waste. So next principle, chemical products should be designed so that at the end of their function, they do not persist in the environment and releases toxic degradation product into soil and atmosphere. So this is what one of the very important principle, as we know that there is tremendous amount of use of fertilizers in the agricultural. So what happened? All these are synthetic, no doubt. So there is at the end of their function, they may remain into the environment. So as what happened, they impact on the insects. And we know that insects are the play main role in the pollination. So this we have to check, that is the degradation of the chemical after its function. Design such chemical products which degrade automatically into environment without releasing toxic effect. Avoid the plastic products as it needs millions of years to decompose. We use the plastic, we know that there is ban from government side, but there is not restriction, too much restriction. So this plastic requires millions of years to decompose. So this is our individual duty to avoid the plastic. And the next, that is analytical methodologies need to be developed to allow for real timing process monitoring and control prior to the formation of hazardous substance. So we have to develop such analytical tool so as to monitor the reaction progress. So there is no formation of any undesirable substance during the course of the reaction. So at our level, we have used the TLC, but at industry, at research center, there are so many advanced analytical tools to check this reaction course. as there is not the formation of hazardous substance. And the last principle, the substances used in the chemical process should be chosen so to minimize the potential of chemical product. So we have to choose such a chemical that avoid the chemical accident, as like the release of methyl isocyanate in the Bhopal. Now the next point, E factor. So E factor, it is an indicator of the pollution effect caused on the environment on account of waste generated in the reaction. It is the ratio of mass of waste effluent to the mass of the desired product in kilogram. So therefore, more of the mass effluent, greater will be the E factor and greater will be the environmental pollution. Here, for example, 44 kg of ethylene oxide produced, 111 kg of effluent of calcium chloride. So E factor indicates what? The total waste in kg divided by total product. Here total waste is calcium chloride, which is of 111 kg divided by total product, that is our desired product, that is ethylene oxide, that is 44 kg. So 111 by 44 is equal to 2.5. So one must have to check the E factor of the reaction. Smaller the E factor of the reaction will be the desired condition for that reaction. So less waste is generated during the course of the reaction. Now the atom economy. Concept of atom economy was developed by Barry Trost of Stanford University and modified by Roger Sheldon. A reaction is said to be atom economical if most of the atoms of the reactants are incorporated into the desired product. So formula, percent autonomy is equal to molecular weight of desired product divided by molecular weight of desired product plus molecular weight of byproduct into 100. So here the example of diol-sulfur reaction between butadiene and ethene. So in this reaction, what happens is percent atom economy, that is product is cyclohexene. So molecular weight is 82. And as per the formula, molecular weight of desired product into a plus molecular weight of byproduct. Here byproduct is zero. Therefore, 82 divided by 82 plus zero into 100. That is what 100% atom economy. So whenever there is organic synthesis, try to enhance the atom economy. So atom economy indicate the whatever the atoms, number of atoms in the molecule in the starting material converts into the desirable product. Now the green synthesis in industry, what type of green synthesis may be occur? So green starting material, that is the commodity chemicals. So commodity chemicals are demanded in large quantities for the global need. Here the example of glucose. Glucose is an excellent feedstock to synthesize a variety of commodity chemicals using biochemical path. This route helps to minimize the use of carcinogenic starting materials such as benzene. So here, see, the there are two ways to synthesize the adipic acid, one of the commodity chemicals for the synthesis of nylon 66 fiber and other product is also, it is raw material for other useful product also. So there are two ways. By one traditional route to use the benzene to form adipic acid. So this is the benzene convert into the cyclohexane and then cyclohexanol by using this different reagents. So this is what the traditional way. But we have the alternative path, that is green approach for synthesis of adipic acid, is the D-glucose in the E. coli media converts into the intermediate product, that is 3-dehydroxyacetic acid and meconic acid, and which in the last step by hydrogenation in the presence of platinum converts into the adipic acid. So this is what the green approach, no waste, no solvent, so no pollution. So this is what the green approach for synthesis of the commodity chemicals. Now, halide free synthesis of aromatic amine. So this is the one of the another alternative way to synthesize 4-amine diphenylamine, which was developed by Monsanto. The process avoid traditional chlorination reaction. See in this reaction here that traditional chlorination reaction, benzene is converted into chlorobenzene, and then this intermediate products, and then finally that is 4-aminodiphenylamine. But we have to synthesize the same product by the green approach by using this tetra ammonium hydroxide and H2 and metal catalysts such as platinum and palladium. This platinum and palladium are the green reagent because we reuse it, recycle it for the further synthesis. So every time we have to focus on this alternative green path for the organic synthesis. Another example, the use of supercritical carbon dioxide. This is the green solvent. So water, supercritical carbon dioxide. So for the organic synthesis. Traditional hydrocarbon-based solvents have number of environmental problems due to which benign solvents which are eco-friendly have been developed. Supercritical CO2, that is at 31 degrees Celsius and 73 atmospheric pressure, and is used as a green solvent in a wide variety of organic reagents. The solvent is non-toxic. Supercritical CO2 is non-toxic, non-inflammable, renewable, inexpensive. So this is what the bromination of toluene to form benzyl bromide. So reaction occur in the presence of supercritical CO2. Now this is the another green solvent, that is the deep eutectic solvent. This deep eutectic solvent is the combination of either urea or glycerol with choline chloride. Choline chloride is nothing but the tertiary ammonium cation. So combination of this urea or glycerol with this tertiary ammonium cation is deep eutectic solvent. This deep eutectic solvent are effective solvent or catalyst for Paulnor synthesis reaction to obtain the pyrrole. So the green approach of this reaction is, the reaction condition is mild and there is no need of Brønsted or Lewis acid catalyst. There are other several uses of this deep eutectic solvent, that is in the electroplating and related metal recovery and separation, and have been found to be excellent solvent for enzymatic reaction, offering much higher activity and stability than organic solvent, even water, potential solvent for the development of prebiotic chemistry. Now, the best approach for the best green approach for this organic synthesis is the microwave assisted organic synthesis. So what are the desirable properties for microwave assisted synthesis for green approach? That is short reaction time, easy workup procedure, reaction may be carried out in the presence of solvent. Solvent free technique is facilitated. The availability of commercial microwave equipment intended for organic chemistry. Now, organic, we know that organic reaction require supply of heat energy. This is generally achieved by using traditional heat transfer equipment such as oil bath, sand bath, and heating jackets. These are generally slow and consume large excess of energy than required. In addition, local overheating may occur, causing decomposition to reagent or product. Microwave irradiation is targeted only to heat the sample, depending on its dielectric behavior. It is easy to control energy supplied to the sample by adjusting the power of the radiation. Now, microwave assisted organic reaction, that is first, that is a pericyclic reaction. We are all familiar with this reaction. So green approach for this reaction is what? The formation of this product from anthracene with dimethyl formate. So reaction proceeds in 10 minutes in para-xylene solvent, and the yield is excellent, that is 87% yield. When we carried out the same reaction in the traditional path, the reaction occurs 4 hours reflux and comparatively yield is low, that is 67% yield. Now the catalytic transfer of hydrogenation. So conversion of benzaldehyde into benzyl alcohol. So green approach for this reaction is what? In the presence of microwave irradiation, reaction was completed in 7 minutes as compared to 4 hours under standard reflux. So more energy is consumed, more time required to complete the reaction. It means more heat is required. More heat means more energy, more consumption. So it is not feasible according to the economic point of view. Next, that is the condensation. Formation of tunoxylenes are effectively synthesized in a few minutes by the condensation in the microwave irradiation. Now, this nitration reaction. The nitration of selected heterocyclic compound is carried out using copper nitrate as a cat in glacial acetic acid. Is a superior reagent than the other. Other metal nitrates are used, but the yield is low. The product was obtained in fairly good yield, enhanced the rate of reaction using microwave irradiation. Now, the role of microwave irradiation in the heterocyclization. So, we know that one of the biologically important molecules, that is 1,5-benzothiazepine, which is the CNS drug, act on the CNS central nervous system, have been synthesized in 75 to 90% yield by microwave prompted condensation of 2-aminothiophenol and various charcoal in the presence of catalytic amount of glacial acetic acid using DMF as a reaction medium. So, in the presence of this microwave irradiation, the yield of reaction is high with less time. Now, the named reaction, that is Michael addition. The advantage of this reaction is that it proceeds without solvent in 15 minutes in excellent yield. So, yield is high as well as short reaction time in the presence of micro-assisted synthesis. Now, Hoffman elimination. This is two-phase water chloroform, 1:1 by volume system. So, containing N2,4-ethoxybenzoyl-ethyl-N,N,N-triethylammonium iodide were heated with stirring in a batch microwave reactor. The green approach of this reaction is reaction offered 97% yield. By traditional path, the yield is low. So Perkin reaction, that is conversion of unsaturated acid by Perkin reaction of aromatic aldehyde with acetic anhydride. This is a simple and efficient approach. The condensation reaction is fast under microwave irradiation and isolated yield of product vary from 20% to 83%. In traditional, the yield is low. Now, next one is the Wolff-Kishner reduction. So, in which we convert the carbonyl group into CH2 group. So, microwave assisted two steps Wolff-Kishner reduction has been carried out in domestic microwave oven in open vessel. The time of reaction was reduced from 3 to 4 hours to 40 seconds under microwave exposure. Reaction was made simple, fast, complicated, workup avoided using mild experimental condition with moderate yield. So this is the desirable green approach for Wolff-Kishner reduction. So we already familiar with this Federal Kraft acylation. So under microwave radiation, Federal Kraft acylation of aromatic compound could be achieved in the presence of graphite powder. The reaction takes place in dry medium. So this is the green approach, solvent free reaction in solid medium. Benzyl benzylic acid rearrangement. Benzyl benzylic rearrangement in the solid state has been developed. Again, solvent free synthesis. A mixture of KOH and benzyl with few drops of water was mixed in a pestle to give a paste, which was then mixed with saline and transferred to a Teflon beaker. The mixture was irradiated in kitchen microwave oven for 45 seconds to get rearranged product in high yield. So reaction duration of reaction is very lower down, that is 45 seconds with high yield. Wittig reaction, that is formation of alkene from carbonyl group. Wittig olefination of lactone and amide with two carbon stable yield. Ethoxy carbonyl methylene triphenyl phosphorine reagent were mixed in 1:1.2 ratio and heated in microwave oven to give a product within 1 to 2 minutes in about 60% to 80% yield. Now this is Hunt-Dekker reactions, which converts this carboxylic acid functional group into the halide functional moiety. A longer duration microwave irradiation, microwave irradiation of 1 to 2 minutes was sufficient to get desirable product. And if the microwave irradiation continued for longer duration, had no significant effect on the yield, but rather caused a decomposition of product. So this is the green approach for Hunt-Dekker reaction. Now here some experimental processes using microwave. So oxidation of toluene using this oxidizing agent, that is sodium dichromate, to form benzoic acid. So reaction takes place in 7 minutes. So the same experimental process and microwave assisted have comparatively status, that is reaction time for microwave is 5 minutes and the yield is 45.5%. For the conventional synthesis, the reaction time is 30 minutes and yield is again comparatively low, that is 34.8. So every in organic synthesis, we have seen the desirable approaches of green synthesis in terms of time and in terms of yield is favorable. Now, this is the oxidation of orthochlorotoluene. So, orthochlorotoluene is converted into orthochlorobenzoic acid by using this oxidizing agent KMnO4. But the comparative study indicate that the microwave needs 10 minutes and yield is 70.09 to obtain orthochlorobenzene acid. By the conventional way, the reaction time is very high, that is 180 minutes, and yield is comparatively low, that is 61.06. Now, oxidation of anthracene into anthraquinone. Here, the comparative study indicates that microwave have favorable on the conventional method. That is, microwave approach required 8 minutes and yield is high, that is 68.5%. For conventional method, the reaction time is 60 minutes and yield is again comparatively low, that is 61.7. Now, the oxidation of benzoin to benzene in the presence of acetic acid. So, microwave synthesis required 10 minutes and yield is 60.6, which is greater than conventional. For conventional, the reaction time is very high again comparatively, that is 120 minutes, and the yield is low, that is 49.8. So here, this is the applications of green organic synthesis, green approach towards the organic synthesis. So here the presentation is over. So anybody have any question regarding this? Please ask.
Anyone have raise your hand, we'll go to unmute your, or you can unmute yourself, we allowed the same. Sir, one question is asked in the YouTube live. What is the basic difference in E factor and atom economy?
E factor and atom economy. Atom economy is what? Whatever atom in the starting material that we have to convert into the desirable product. So whatever atom converts into the desirable product. So less by starting less number of atom from starting material converts into the byproduct, or almost no converts into the byproduct. So this is the benefit of that green approach. And E factor, what E factor indicates? The pollution of that reaction, impact of that reaction on the pollution. So whatever the waste generated, so number of byproduct or need of solvent, so what it creates the pollution. So this is what the higher the E factor, it means higher the byproduct is generated, higher the waste is generated, which is hazardous to the environment.
Sir, one more question from Jaya Shukla, Banaras Hindu University. She asked about what is the use of ionic liquid and how it will be the good alternative as a green solvent.
So ionic liquids, one of the benefit of ionic liquid is it converts into the starting material, converts into the product, and we use the ionic liquid. Liquids are recyclable and we can reuse it for the further synthesis. So this is the benefit of ionic liquids and less byproduct.
Sir, one more question from Hemant Parekh. He asked about is any hazard of microwave synthesis?
Nitrogen synthesis?
Microwave synthesis. Microwave synthesis.
So what happened in microwave synthesis? One of the disadvantage of microwave synthesis is what happened? Whenever we place our reaction into the microwave oven, so as the trial or error basis, what happened, there is no control. Once you start the reaction, we don't have that much control on that reaction. So it will decompose sometime.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. M.K. Patel, sir, to conclude this session.
Before I want to thanks for the session, for giving me this chance.
Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. Friends, we had really an excellent session from Dr. Sushil Ghumre, who has explained green chemistry and its approach towards the organic chemistry. As rightly pointed by him, he explained the concept of green chemistry in a very simple and lucid language. He also explained the need and importance of the green approach in human life and the ill effects of different type of toxic hazardous chemicals such as CFC, liquid CO2, which is greenhouse, MIC, and so on. His talk, he also gave an idea about the aim of green chemistry to eliminate the hazardous chemicals, which can really keep the environment clean and green. So the need to avoid waste such as plastic products, the necessity to develop some analytical tools and methodology to monitor the processes. He pointed the necessity for developing technologies to prevent the exhausting and depletion of resources, specifically with the elements in the periodic table, which is really an alarming situation globally. He also gave some examples with respect to the use of safer solvents like water, alcohol, supercritical CO2, platinum and palladium metals, which has excellent results in some important reactions, organic reactions. The use of deep eutectic solvents and mild conditions, which are used in enzymatic reactions. Also, he has depicted good examples with respect to Perkin reaction, Wolf-Kirchner, Friedel-Crafts reaction, and so on. So, friends, according to him, attempts are being made to quantify the greenness of the chemical processes and improve the chemical yield also. So with this, we have to again look at the price of the reactions, safety in handling the reactions, chemicals, then the energy profile of the reaction, and the ease of the energy product to be worked in. So his talk will definitely awaken the minds of our participants, and it will help to minimize the chemical accidents, exposure, whatever death is occurring to the workers in different type of industries. One most important example which he has expected that with the Bhopal gas tragedy. So such incidents should not occur every now and then, because it will definitely harm the mankind. So many challenges are still ahead, and solutions must be found. So on behalf of Pujya Sani Guruji Vidya Prasarak Mandals Arts Commerce College Shahada, and on behalf of our chemistry department, I thank you, sir, for your intellectual talk, which will help our budding researchers to develop some novel and indigenous methods in their research work. I also thank all the participants for their patience during the whole session, and they were with us. Thank you once again, sir. Over to Dr. Milind.
Thank you once again, sir.
Now, Milind, sir, I have 1 minute.
Yes, sir.
I have 1 minute. So, thanks to the management, that is Honorable President, Secretary of this Samstha and College, to giving me this opportunity to share my views regarding green approach. Again, thanks to Principal Professor R.S. Patil, sir, Vice Principal Professor M.K. Patil, sir. Thank you to Head of the Department, Dr. B.M. Jadhav, sir. And lastly, thank you to Organizing Secretary, Mr. S.R. Uzagre, sir, and Milind, sir, and entire PSGVPM College team of College of Arts, Science and Commerce, Shahada. Thank you.
Thank you, Ghumre, sir. Now I request to all participants, we are moving towards the second session of this workshop. For this second session, may I request Dr. A.G. Veldar, Assistant Professor, formerly working in DRDO laboratories, for his research work and co-convener of this workshop, to chair this session.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
sir. Now, may I request Professor J.U. Chauhan, sir, to introduce our next resource person, Dr. Hemant V. Chauhan, assistant professor and resource person of this webinar from Department of Chemistry, ASP College, Devrul, District Ratnagiri, to our audience. Over to Professor Jagdish Chauhan, sir.
Thank you, Milind sir. Good morning, all. I am Jagdish Chauhan, assistant professor, Department of Chemistry, Pujya Sani Guruji Vidya Prasarak Mandal, Arts Science Commerce College, Shahada. It's my great pleasure to introduce today's resource person, Dr. Hemant Vilas Chauhan, sir. Dr. Hemant Chauhan, working as an assistant professor at ASP College, Devrukh Ratnagiri, he has more than 12 years of teaching and research experience. He received his PhD from the Solapur University under the supervision of Professor B.P. Bangar, sir, ex-Vice-Chancellor, Solapur University. He published more than 48 research papers in international and national reputed journal. He completed one minor project and currently working on major project of 18 lakhs. He also awarded with many honors. The honors are the Teachers Associateship for the Research Excellence, DST Sir, Government of India. He also awarded with the Senior Research Fellow Award, Junior Research Award by CSIR, New Delhi. His area of research is synthetic organic chemistry, heterocyclic chemistry, bioorganic chemistry, medicinal chemistry, green chemistry. So I requested Dr. Hemant Chauhan sir to deliver his valuable talk on green chemistry, a basis for sustainable future. Sir, please.
Thank you very much, sir. So friend, first of all, I must thank the organizers and all the authorities of the ACS College, Arts Commerce Science College, Shahada, for inviting me and organizing this wonderful webinar. Friends, actually this COVID-19 pandemic is a very critical situation for all of us. But I must highlight one positive point because of this COVID-19 pandemic is that we all are able to connect with each other through the technology. As I am far away from your college and it might be around 700 to 800 kilometers away, the distance in between us. So this is the positive thing happened because of this COVID-19 pandemic. And it was not happened before this. And earlier, we were not able to connect with each other. Or another possibility that might be we were negligent or we not aware about this use of this fruitful use of this technology. And the sharing technology used for the sharing of experiences of the expert, sharing of the knowledge and many things. So people's came closer due to the technology, and they are sharing their knowledge, sharing their experiences with each other. And through such a webinars, students of far remote areas, remote places are able to connect with each other or connect with the experts of their interest. So this is actually the good thing happened because of this COVID-19 pandemic. So we should take it positively with this aspect. So I pray to the God that he keep us all of us safe, as well as we will come to the track very soon or come to our regular routine very soon. So now come to the theme of this talk. I selected this theme of the talk because green chemistry is a very much hot topic nowadays or currently throughout the world. As so in the beginning, before going to actual talk of this webinar. I share my presentation over here with you. Okay. So am I audible for all? And my screen is visible in the full screen mode.
Yes, sir.
Yes, it's okay.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Please continue.
So the talk of the theme of my talk is green chemistry, which is a basis for the sustainable future. So first of all, we all are aware about this thing. So that is industrial pollution. Then many crises nowadays we are facing. So first crisis is the industrial pollution. We are coming across many adverse effects of this industrial pollution. Then industrial waste generation, which is again one of the more crucial difficulty in front of all of us. So this industrial waste also produces many difficulties to human beings. And we might familiar that our country nowadays, though we are very much ahead in the productions of pharmaceuticals, but what actually happened? So many pharmaceutical industries are trying to raise or erect their production units in the India. And the most important reason behind this is certain policies or some easily available manpower for this pharmaceutical industries, and due to which, as though we are producing many important pharmaceuticals and providing to entire world, but the situation nowadays is our country is becoming dumping ground somewhere. So we need to take this issue very seriously. Because of these production units, because of these chemical production units throughout the India, many industries are polluting our atmosphere, polluting our environment. So we need to focus towards this issue. Then another issue is the emission, carbon emission. So many industries evolving a greater quantity of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, and the carbon dioxide emission leads to various issues to the atmosphere. The issues generally because of this emission of hazardous gases, hazardous chemicals into the atmosphere that leading to global warming. Then one more issue we are facing nowadays, that is the change in climate or climate change. Just now you might see in the photographs of Konkan region as well as from Kolhapur and Sangli region. So we are facing so many issues because of this climate change. Uneven rainfall, heavy rainfall somewhere there is a drought. And these issues many times we are facing within just three to 5 years. Then we are facing the issues of water crisis. Somewhere there are issues of water crisis, somewhere there are issues of the floods. And these uneven environmental issues are another one more problem in front of the humans. So in conclusion, these are the issues in front of the whole world, or whole world facing these issues like enhanced global warming, depletion of resources, increase of extreme weather events, as we just seen in the previous month, spread of the various kinds of diseases, as we are facing food shortage, shortage of the potable water, housing issues, and waste generation or waste treatment. So these are the various issues or hot issues entire world is facing. And we are trying to combat this issue on various levels. And the important question in front of us is now, the important question is, how can chemistry contribute to overcome these issues? This is the more important question in front of us. So, so I hope many students studying in the field of chemistry or doing chemistry at undergraduate or postgraduate levels as well as some students pursuing their PhDs connected with us. For them, it is it should be very clear, whenever we practice chemistry, maybe it is organic, inorganic, physical, analytical, or any stream of the chemistry, if we focus on the practices producing less waste, consuming less energy, consuming the less efforts, consuming the less chemicals, consuming less water, then the chemistry is considered to be the green chemistry. So what is the solution for this global issues? So the solution is nothing but the green chemistry. So final solution is the green chemistry, and green chemistry help us to prevent the pollution which is occurring because of this pharmaceutical industries, chemical industries, or pesticide industries, and it helps to sustain the earth, or it helps to sustaining the earth by preventing the pollution. If we are able to prevent the pollution, then and then only sustain the earth. Otherwise, it is very difficult in next 10 to 15 years or 10 to 20 years. Our situation will be very critical. Nowadays, we are facing a lot of challenges like this. And if we are not able to combat the challenges, if we are not ready to focus towards the challenges, if we are not able to practice the green chemistry, then it is very difficult to tackle these type of issues. Okay, so what do you mean by the green chemistry? So as we just discussed, green chemistry is nothing but the So green chemistry is nothing but the focusing on the practices which produces the least waste, less energy. And we all are familiar that in every chemical or pharmaceutical process or every chemical process, these are the steps which are involved. These are the steps which are normally involved. What are these steps? Heating, cooling, stirring, distillation, compression, pumping, separation, etc., etc. So most of the processes requires all these things, or requires or involves all these steps. And all these steps requires energy. And this energy is in the form of electricity. And from where this electricity comes? With this electricity comes from the various burning of various fossil fuels. If we burn a lot of fossil fuels to fulfill our energy requirement, that leads to the production of greater quantity of the harmful gases like carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide. And these gases leads to the issues like global warming and climate change. And this global warming and climate change issues leads to the sustainability issues or environmental sustainability issues. So if we want to get rid from this environmental sustainability issue, then we need to focus on the energy minimization of our energy requirements. If we are able to minimize our energy requirement, then and then only we can able to sustain our future, or we can able to sustain the future of our coming generations. Otherwise, it is very difficult for all of us to tackle in the future to various issues. So we all are familiar that what are the problems? So problems are to fulfill our the energy needs. We are totally dependent on the natural resources. So we are exploiting the natural resources. We are consuming a lot of natural resources. We are going to a deforestation. So because of all these three, exploitation of natural resources, consumption, deforestation, three more issues arises in front of us. And that might be because of population explosion, urbanization, industrialization. These are the three issues. And if you want to combat these three issues, there are some consequences as well as there are some needs. And there are some needs to fulfill the needs to fulfill the requirements of the growing population, urbanization, and industrialization. What are the consequences? Consequences are the urban degradation, greenhouse gases, global warming, ozone depletion, and extinction of wildlife. So these are the consequences. And apart from this, there are some needs to fulfill the demands of this growing population. That we need a clean environment. We need a population prevention. We need waste minimization. Eco-friendly processes or eco-friendly methods we need to develop. And most important issue or need is the health and safety or safer atmosphere, which leads to, or we call it as a healthy atmosphere. So these are the needs of our current generation. So if we want to fulfill all these needs, then the solution is we need to stop urbanization, we need to stop industrialization, or we need to stop population explosion. But it is possible. Is it possible? No. We didn't able to stop, or we are not able to stop the urbanization. We never stop industrialization, because these are the needs of the these are the things which fulfills our requirements. And if we are not able to stop the industrialization, then what will be the solution? As we are not able to stop the industrialization, the solution is only the green chemistry. So green chemistry can help us to reach our goal. Or what are our goals? What are our needs? These are the needs: to acquire clean environment, waste minimization, eco-friendly methods, then safety and health, or health and safety. So these goals we can achieve to a certain extent with the help of green chemistry. Not it is easily possible, not 100% green chemistry help us to achieve all these things. But to a certain extent, green chemistry will help us to fulfill these needs or to achieve our goals to a certain extent. And if we follow the 12 principles of green chemistry, these 12 principles of green chemistry will help us to reach our goals. What are these 12 principles? I will not go in detail with these 12 principles of the green chemistry, because these 12 principles of green, so previous our resource person who already, So these 12 principles of green chemistry, such as prevention of the waste, atomic economy, less hazardous chemical synthesis, designing safer chemicals, safer solvents and auxiliaries, energy efficient procedures, processes, use of renewable resources, reduced derivatives, safer catalysis, design for degradation, real-time analysis for pollution prevention, safer chemicals for accident prevention. So all these 12 principles of green chemistry, or if we follow the practices according to these 12 principles of green chemistry, then definitely we can sustain our future life of our future generation, or we can sustain our environment. And if we can able to sustain our environment, then we can able to sustain our future. Okay, so what do you mean by the term green chemistry? What do you understand from the term green chemistry? So green chemistry is nothing but, or green chemistry is also called as a sustainable chemistry, and which enables chemists to create safe, energy efficient and non-toxical chemical products and processes without harming human health and the environment. So this is nothing but the green chemistry. And it is a more sophisticated way of doing the chemistry. Green chemistry is a more sophisticated way of doing chemistry at preventing pollution and health problems at the chemical design stage. So through this green chemistry, we just have to focus on the preventing pollution. Our green chemistry focuses on prevention of the pollution and to minimize the health issues at the chemical design stage. So this is nothing but the green chemistry. And we all are familiar that the field of green chemistry has seen many scientific discoveries and inventions during the last 20 years. Because this term green chemistry was coined by the renowned scientists, that is Paul T. Anastas and John Warner, who were called as the father of the green chemistry. And after the discovery of this green chemistry principles or green chemistry term, it's around 20 years. And during these 20 years of time span, a lot of discoveries and a lot of inventions are going on to achieve our the desired needs. Okay, so the word sustainability, what we expect from this word sustainability or sustainable development or sustainable future. Sustainable future means meeting the needs of our needs of the present generation without compromising the needs of the future generation. But do you think, is it actually happening? No, it is not actually happening, because most of the people are trying to exploit the nature, trying to exploit the resources which are available in the nature for meeting their needs in the present. So if we want to achieve the sustainability, or if we want to achieve the sustainable future, if we want to sustain the future of our coming generation, then we need to focus, or we need to focus on the green chemistry practices, and which help us to need the which help us to meet the needs of present generation without compromising the needs of the future generations. Otherwise, whatever may be the resources available currently, these resources sometimes may vanishes after 20 years or after 30 years or after say 50 years or after 100 years. Some resources may vanishes after 5 to 10 years, or after vanishes after 10 to 15 years, 20 years, after 100 years. So if these natural resources are over, then think what will happen. So we have to find out the various alternatives through which we can able to meet our needs without compromising the needs of the coming, our coming generations or our future. So then the green chemistry works towards the sustainability. As we know, green chemistry works towards the sustainability by making the chemical products that do not harm either our health or environment. How to achieve the goal of sustainability with the help of the green chemistry? By making the chemical products that do not harm either our health or either our environment. Then using industrial processes that reduce or eliminate hazardous chemicals. We need to design such industrial processes that help us to reduce the waste or eliminate the hazardous chemicals from the atmosphere. Then designing more efficient processes. We have to focus on the designing of more efficient processes that minimizes the production of waste materials. We need to focus on the design of the more efficient processes that minimizes the production of waste materials. Means we need to focus on the atom economy. Theoretical atom economy is different. Practical atom economy. We need practical atom economy. So this atom economy will help us to minimize the waste produced from various chemical processes. Then preventing pollution before it happens, rather than cleaning up the mess later. We need to, our primary target will be to prevent the pollution or prevent the waste before it generates or before it happens, rather than cleaning up the waste later. So it is not much important to clean up the waste later, but it is important we have to focus on the practices which will help us to prevent the pollution or prevent the waste. And then saving, and all these practices leads to saving companies their money by using less energy and fewer or safer chemicals, thus reducing the cost of pollution control and waste proposal. Okay, so saving companies money by using the less energy and fewer or safer chemicals, thus reducing the cost of the pollution control and waste disposal. So if we follow all these practices, then we can able to achieve the sustainability. So the more important thing in front of us, as I just said, it is better to prevent the waste rather than to treat or clean up waste before waste after it forms. So it is not an easy or a good way to clean up the waste or treat the waste, whatever the waste formed from these different chemical processes. So it is better to think about the processes or such a chemical processes which are preventing the waste generation. So this is more important, and it can be achieved only with the help of the green chemistry. So to achieve all those things, we need to focus upon all these parameters, which our previous resource person already explained about these things. We need to focus on the person, greater yield of the product, greater percent atom economy, experimental atom economy, percent yield, E factor, F factor. And if we follow the practices accordingly, if we try to increase our atom economy in this process, or if we want to, if we are able to focus, or if we are focusing on all such things, then we can very easily able to achieve all our goals. So we must need to focus on the percent atom economy, experimental atom economy. It is not essential to focus on the theoretical reactant conversion efficiency. It needs to be focused on the experimental reactant conversion efficiency. How much is the extra? If we are able to improve the experimental reactant conversion efficiency, then ultimately it leads to decrease in the waste generated from the various processes. Okay, so I'm not going in detail with this because already our previous expert resource person covered all those things. So how to calculate all those parameters, that I'm not going in detail. So achieve all those things, so to achieve the sustainability or towards going to the sustainability, we need to focus, or since from last 20 years focusing on certain issues, and still there are lot of scope, there is a lot of scope to go ahead in these areas. So what are these areas since last 20 years scientists are focusing? So scientists are focusing first on minimizing the dependence on fossil fuels. So nowadays, we peoples are greatly dependent on the fossil fuels. And this is one of the key challenges we face, continues to be decreasing our dependence on fossil fuels for chemicals and fuel productions. This is one of the key challenges in front of us. We need to minimize our dependence on the fossil fuels in terms of chemicals or in terms of fuel production. So if we are self-dependent, and when we achieve the goal that we are self-dependent, we are not completely depends on the fossil fuels, because in future, one day we don't have all these fossil fuels, then what will happen? What our future generation will do? What is our future? Whether it is sustainable? No. So entire globe trying to minimize the dependence on the fossil fuels. So in accordance to achieve this goal, many scientists are working to develop some green practices or green methods, green solutions to these problems. And we succeeded to certain extent, but not at all levels. So there is a lot of scopes in the future in this area as well. So this entails both the efficient and clean transformation of renewable raw materials into functional chemicals and fuels, as well as efficient CO2 capture and conversion into fuels and chemicals. As there is a growing industrialization, there is an increase in the emission of carbon dioxide in the nature, in the environment. So we need to capture that carbon dioxide and we need to convert the carbon dioxide into various energy sources. And if we focus more on the use of the renewable resources or biobased resources as a raw materials for the conversion of or for the synthesis of the functional chemicals and fuels, when we able to achieve these goals or able to succeed in these areas, then and then only we can able to minimize our dependence on the fossil fuels. And we succeeded to a certain extent. Many people have developed some methods which very easily captures the carbon dioxide and converts into fuels and some important chemicals. So the examples through which we can achieve this goal is biomass derived renewable carbonaceous materials for sustainable chemical and environmental applications. Biomass derived renewable carbonaceous materials. So the materials or raw materials we are using as a biomasses for the production of some useful chemical substances and which will helps to attain the sustainability of the environment. So as we all are familiar that our biosphere comprises abundant polymers such as cellulose, chitin, chitosan, possessing highly desirable traits with biodegradability and renewability being the prominent ones. These are the various substances which are abundantly available in the nature. These are the abundant biopolymers like cellulose, chitin and chitosan. So these are the most abundant biopolymers which we are using. They have the properties like biodegradability and they are easily renewable. These are the sources of renewable substances. So if we focus on the conversion of such a biomasses into the desired chemicals, then we can able to minimize our dependence on the fossil fuels. So these are the various structures of these chemicals like cellulose, chitin, chitosan, and certain types of cyclodextrins, etc. Then these renewable resources can made increasingly viable technology and economically through green chemistry. We can only able to convert these renewable resources, or we need to convert these renewable resources into our desired chemical products with the help of a technology. But these processes must be technically as well as economically viable. If we are designing such a green practices, but if these green practices are not economically viable, then we are not able to use such a practices. So if we are trying to develop some technology based on the green chemistry principles, if we are trying to develop the green chemistry processes, then such a processes must be economically viable. So many scientists or many chemists in the world working in this aspect, but and they have succeeded to a certain extent, and they are trying to convert this earth abundant material and waste normally from the fields or from the the waste generated from the sea. So all such a waste are easily trying to convert into carbonaceous materials, and these carbonaceous materials we are using for the production of polymers and then pharmaceuticals and in any other different chemical areas. But we while designing all those things, we succeeded to a certain extent, but still more focus is necessary to make these processes economically viable. We have developed these processes, but certain processes are only meets the need of economical viability. So if we further extend our research and if we succeed in the future to achieve this convergence, which is more technologically viable as well as economically viable, then we can decrease our dependence on the renewable resources. This is one more example, which we call it as lignin is available as available in high amounts from lignocellulosic residues from the processing of agriculture or forest biomass. Every year we produce lot of agriculture waste, lot of forest biomass, and from which or by processing the lignocellulosic residues from these biomasses, we can able to extract the lignin, and this lignin as a sustainable source to obtain the valuable products. So many chemical or scientists working in the field of organic synthesis or organic chemistry, they are trying to prepare the diverse array of functional chemicals or the monomers required for the production of bio-friendly or biodegradable polymers. Because polymer is again one of the hot issue nowadays we are facing due to their less degradation abilities. So for the production of biodegradable polymers, so scientists are focusing on the use of these lignin monomers, and so many other functional chemicals are also we can isolate from such a natural resources, which are called as the renewable resources of energy. And what are the applications of this? These applications of this lignin, it's in the field of production of power, biofuels, and syngases, syngas products, as well as formation of macromolecules such as plastic, polymeric foams, membranes, etc., and of low molecular weight phenolic compounds. So in these different areas, we are using this lignin, lignin polymers, and the functional materials we isolated with the help of this. So if we are able to develop such a environment-friendly processes or such a chemical extraction processes from the biomasses produced, then and then only we can we will be self-dependent in the future. And we are now we have the sustainable source of energy through this renewable resources, and our dependence on the non-renewable resources we can able to minimize. So this type of advancements only possible with the help of green chemistry practices, and we should follow the green chemistry practices during achieving all those things. And if we are extracting lot of things from the natural resources, but we are not following the green chemistry practices, we are producing much more waste, which is not our required condition. So while designing any such a chemical processes or while designing the extraction procedures, we need to follow the green chemistry practices, and we have to develop some green chemistry technologies which will help us to achieve that goal. Then second important area which we need to focus, that is our scientists are focusing continuously, that is minimizing the impact of chemical synthesis and manufacturing. So we need to focus or continuously since last 20 years, scientists focusing on the minimization of minimizing the impact of chemical synthesis and manufacturing, because through this chemical synthesis and manufacturing, we are producing a lot of waste, and that waste every day, several metric tons waste generated, and that enters into the various various resources of environment. So this minimizing the impact of chemical synthesis is another key challenge in developing manufacturing infrastructure for the circular economy. The circular economy, which must through which we can minimize both the environmental impact of the manufacturing processes of the chemicals, as well as their potential hazards and persistence of the commodity chemicals produced. So, through this goal or through this circular economy, we can able to minimize the environmental impact of the manufacturing processes, of manufacturing processes, as well as the potential hazards and stability of these chemicals in the atmosphere or persistence of the commodity chemicals. As we all are familiar that nowadays we are running out of these key elements. Some of the key elements are very rare in the atmosphere nowadays. why we are running out of these key elements, which elements which are in danger zone. So if you are able to see this green portions or the elements present in the green color, that is rhodium, silver, gold, zinc, there is an exhaustive extraction of these elements or exhaustive withdrawal of these elements from the nature. And if you see here, if we start withdrawing this or consuming these chemicals with the current rate, then these yellow colored chemicals might running out during 100 to 1000 years. But if you look at these green chemicals, these chemicals or these type of elements present in the nature, we run out within 5 to 50 years. So if we finish all these chemicals, then what will happen in the future? So why there is a exhaustive use of these chemicals? Because exhaustive use of these metals, these are generally metals we are using for our many regular practices. In chemical industry, specifically as a catalyst, many scientists are nowadays focusing on the metal catalyst, precious metal catalyst. And if we are consuming a lot of precious metal catalyst to a greater extent, then in future, these chemicals may running out or running out. Or their abundance is already very less. And if we are consuming those chemicals with to greater extent, then in future, no such elements are available on the earth. So we need to focus on this, because many chemical processes, we are using the metal catalyst. And we all are familiar that the metal, after the completion of the process or after the completion of the reaction, whatever may be the waste generated from that process, if we are using the metal catalysis, then these metals as a contaminant must present in those wastewaters or wastewater generated from that industries. So these metals leads to various adverse effects on the human beings as well as on the aquatic animals. Because this waste is continuously entering into our various water resources, and there is a wastewater pollution because of this heavy metals as well. So we need to minimize, or we need to shorten the use of such metals in various chemical processes. Thus, catalysis with earth abundant rather than precious metals. We need to focus on the catalysis with earth abundant metals, not on the precious metals. Because many scientists are focusing on the silver catalysis, gold catalysis, rhodium catalysis, tin as a catalyst, zinc as a catalyst, as well as even we are working on the gold and platinum as well. So if we are consuming these precious metals to greater extent, then definitely these elements nowhere in the atmosphere in the coming future. So we need to focus on the catalysis with earth abundant elements rather than precious metal. This area is remained as an active area of research and key components of sustainable chemistry research. If you focus on the less use of these precious metals and more use of the earth abundant metals in the field of catalysis or in the field of organic synthesis, then this will be the key component of sustainable chemistry research. Thus, to minimize the impact of the chemical synthesis and manufacturing researchers focusing on various parameters. These researchers are focusing on various practices. One of the practices, designing of metal-free catalyst, metal-free or catalyst-free reaction. So most of the green chemists are trying to design and develop such a processes in which there is no involvement of catalyst, or there is no involvement of any kinds of heavy or toxic metals. And if we are able to, or if we are succeed in the designing and development of such a processes in which There is no use of heavy metal catalyst, no use of toxic catalyst, toxic metals, and toxic solvents as well. And these methods are easy to purify. Then we can very easily able to minimize the impact of this chemical synthesis on and manufacturing on the human health. So many scientists, these are the some recent papers which are published in the journal which is called as Organic Letters, 2019 and 2020. So these are the reports which gives us an idea, insight that many scientists are focusing on the development of catalyst-free reactions as well as metal-free catalysis using in the field of generation of the different types of pharmaceuticals. This is one of the practice through which we can able to achieve our target. Then we can also use recyclable and biodegradable catalyst such as enzyme catalysis, natural catalysts like clays and plant extracts and some other environmental friendly catalyst. If we use in our chemical processes, then such a processes are also helps to acquire the sustainability. So biocatalysis is nowadays one of the emerging area in through which many researchers are trying to design such a processes in which there is a less waste generation, or there is a no use of hazardous catalysts, there is no use of hazardous solvents, and most of the catalyst we are using, if there is a no alternative or no eco-friendly option available, there is only option of use of metal catalyst, then people are trying to develop such a metal catalyst which are easily recyclable. So that's why many people are focusing on the development of such a nanoparticles or nanoparticles based catalyst which will help us to achieve the target of recycling. Means though we are dependent on such a catalyst, but we can able to recycle those catalysts. If you are able to recycle such a catalyst, then also we can able to minimize the use of such a precious metals. So recyclability of the catalyst, if we achieve the more energy efficient methods using such a catalyst, then these methods are also we need to focus on environmental viability, industrial viability of these methods. So nowadays there are several environmental friendly methods are developed, but the issue is with this most of the methods is industrial viability. So most some of the methods can be efficient on small scale basis, but not efficient on large scale basis. So we need to focus on the improvement of this scalability issues with the help of such a recyclable catalyst or with the help of such a biodegradable catalyst. If we use biodegradable catalyst, then we can helps to solve to certain extent the issues of water pollutions or issues of the pollution of various water resources. Because nowadays there is an issue of potable water is again for the various metropolitan cities. Potable water, as we call, there is our right to obtain the enough potable water which is suitable for the drinking or our daily need purposes. But if we are not able to concentrate on the design and development of or following the green practices, then in future we need to fight for the acquiring or for potable water resources. That might be happens. So sometimes we can say that third world war will be for water, and it might happen if we are not ready to minimize the use of such a water resource. So that we focus in our next slides as well. So in this regards, we also contributed to certain extent, and we developed one method for the synthesis of the cinnamic acid derivatives via Nouwenjil condensation reactions. And in this conversion, along with ceramic acids as well as 3-carboxy synthesis of the 3-carboxy cumarins, which is used as a intermediate for various pharmaceuticals. So we have developed this chemical method or chemical protocol with the help of aqueous extract of acacia concina pods. We all are familiar that acacia concina. Acacia concina is a Marathi we call it as a shikakai. So with the help of the aqueous extract of the shikakai, so we all are familiar that acacia concina pods can be used for the washing of hair. Means as we using as a natural surfactant, means it has some natural surfactants in that water extract. And when we use such a natural surfactant, means as it contains some natural surfactant, means these surfactants or surfactant catalysis is also a part of green chemistry. Means if we use such a natural surfactants or natural catalyst for the chemical synthesis processes, then such a processes also helps to minimize the impact of this chemical synthesis on the human health. Okay, so using this aqueous extract of this acacia concina pods, we have successfully achieved the synthesis of a diverse array of these 3-carboxy cumarins and ceramic acids via the Nouwenjil condensation reactions. And this process easily completed within just 5 to 10 minutes. We can achieve the conversion of this 3-carboxy cumarins as well as the ceramic acid derivatives just within 5 to 10 minutes. So use of such a green catalyst, use of such a biodegradable catalyst can also help us to sustain our atmosphere. So as well as we tried these reactions on some gram scale basis, and we successfully able to achieve the synthesis of both of these compounds. And the interesting thing is that when we used the catalyst at room temperature, we acquired these 3-carboxy cumarins in good yields. However, when we use the same catalyst and applied the temperature around 60 degrees centigrade, there is a conversion of this 3-carboxy cumarins is achieved into ceramic acids. So we can easily able to use this technology for the preparations of these ceramic acids or preparation of these 3-carboxy cumarins. And the mechanism involved in this reaction is this micelle-catalyzed synthesis or micelle-catalyzed mechanism is involved for these conversions. Because when we tried the different concentrations over here for this, and this 20% concentration is found to be more suitable concentration for the conversion. So this micelle-catalyzed conversion help us to achieve the synthesis of these different chemicals like 3-carboxy cumarins and these ceramic acid derivatives. And there is one more possibility in this reaction. That possibility is the reaction might proceed through the biocatalysis. Biocatalysis means biocatalysis involves the enzyme catalysis as well. So enzyme catalysis is one of the key area, that one of the important area in this green chemistry practices. So use of so this reaction, there is a possibility, there was a possibility that the reaction, whether that reaction proceeds through the micellar, through the surfactants or due to the enzymes present in this aqueous extracts. But as we extracted this acacia concina pods under boiling water, and when we extract the any substances under boiling water, so at around 100 degrees centigrade, so no any enzymes normally retains their shape or retains their properties. So in this reaction, there is no possibility of enzyme catalyzed reactions, but the possibility, only possibility, is the efficient surfactant type is surfactant catalysis for the conversion of this. So, and we published this article in the well-reputed journal, that is ECS Sustainable Chemistry and Engineering, with impact factor 8.1. So if we trying to focus on the green chemistry practices, then we can easily able to achieve or contribute to the practices of green chemistry. Then another way of achieving or minimizing the impact of chemical processes is reactions. We need to focus on the reactions in the aqueous medium or by using some green solvents, because most of the organic processes requires toxic solvents or solvents which are normally not safer to the human health. And again, after completion of the reactant, we need to recover those solvents which we are using for that particular process. Means if we are need to recovery of these chemical recovery of solvents, means we need energy. If we focus on the reactions specifically in aqueous medium or using some green solvents, then such a mediums in if we are performing the reactions in aqueous medium, then there is no need to recover the solvent from that reaction medium. So we can easily able to expel that solvent or easily able to send that solvent to send it to the atmosphere. But if we use some greener solvents, then also if these solvents enters into the atmosphere, then such a solvents not creates any hazards to the atmosphere. So these are some examples I will show you where there is no use of if you look at the conversion of this product, then there is no use of any organic solvent at any stage. So such a convergence or such a areas many scientists are seeing. And then deep eutectic solvents, the examples of greener solvents is the deep eutectic solvents or the solvents like some green ethers, ether based solvents, as well as the use of ionic liquids or some other solvents which are safer to the atmosphere. If you are consistently using these safer solvents or focusing on the safer solvents for the organic processes, then it is easy or it could help us to achieve the goal of minimizing the impact of this chemical processes. Then one more practice we can follow, that is use of organocatalysts. We need to focus on the use of organic. As we just seen, there is a scarcity of various metal catalysts. So many organic processes were using some heterogeneous metal catalysts. And that leads to some health hazards, as well as there is a generation of, or there is a scarcity of there is a losing their existence from the nature. So instead of using heterogeneous metal catalyst, if we focus on the use of some organic organocatalyst which are abundant in the nature, then these organocatalysts also help us to minimize the impact. These as well as along with this use of organic catalyst, we need to focus on the recycling, as well as use of the mild reaction conditions, use of green solvents. And if we use all those things in combination, then very easily we can able to save our atmosphere. We can able to reduce the waste generating toxic waste generating from the chemical industries. And many industries nowadays focusing on these issues, but so still lot of work needs to be carried out in these areas. Then the third challenge or third most focusing area in front of us, designing chemicals with minimal hazards. So many pharmaceuticals or chemicals which are nowadays present in the, or nowadays we are using, or nowadays using in various pharmaceutical industries, some of these chemicals have potential health hazards. So while designing any drug molecules, or while designing any chemical substance, first of all, we need to focus on how to minimize the toxicity levels of such a chemicals. So before going for the synthesis or for a production of such a chemicals, with the help of some chemical softwares or with the help of some computer-based softwares, we can able to screen the toxicity level of these type of chemicals by comparing the toxicities or by comparing the structures of the previous or presently available toxic chemicals. So while minimizing the impact of chemicals through the use of renewable resources and cleaner processes technologies remains critical. The importance of the toxicological profile of these chemicals being circulated is now increasingly being recognized. So we need to focus on the designing of safer chemicals. And the challenge of efficiently accessing the toxicological risk of thousands of chemicals at the design stage and for the chemicals already in the use requires interdisciplinary research efforts. Why this is required and why this is a challenge? Because many or thousand numbers or lakhs of chemicals are available we are using nowadays in different for the different purposes, either in the field of pharmaceutical, either in the field of agrochemicals, either in the field of pesticides, or either in the field of cleaning agents. Everywhere we are using different chemical agents, but still we are not aware about the exact toxicological profile of these thousands of chemicals. So in the future, we need to focus on the screening of these toxicological effects, and it could be only possible with the help of the interdisciplinary approach. Okay, if we follow the interdisciplinary approaches, then and then only we can able to tackle, or we can able to find out which chemicals are potentially toxic in the nature, and then and then only we can able to avoid the use of such a toxic chemicals, and or we need to focus on the replacement of such a toxic chemicals by lesser toxic or more safer chemicals, less toxic chemicals. If we are able to replace, then and then only we can able to minimize the hazards of such a toxic chemicals on human being or on the environment. So many toxicological mechanisms of interactions remain poorly understood and therefore unregulated. Many toxicological mechanisms. Whenever industry launches any new drug or launches any new chemical products in the market, most of the times few dimensions are taken in care, but 100% toxicological mechanisms are not clearly understood. Nowadays, we are dealing with COVID-19 vaccines. So many people are still in confusion whether these vaccines are safe or not, because most of the vaccines are hurriedly reached into the market. And the toxicological mechanism, or whether clear mechanism of toxicity or clear mechanism of the toxic effect of these vaccines are still not 100% understood. But we know whenever there is an issue of existence, at that time, first of all, we need to focus on our existence. Then, afterwards, we focus on the side effects of such a medicine, side effects of any chemicals. So, whenever there is an issue of life, life-saving issues, then we need to focus, first of all, saving the life. Then, later on, we focus on the their side effects. So we need to find out the exact mechanism of interactions or toxicological mechanisms of interactions of various chemicals which are present with us nowadays. So this is one of the example that is per or polyfluoroalkyl substances. These are the group of substances that which are called as perfluoroalkyl substances or polyfluoroalkyl substances, which are used in various functions, or these functions in many capacities, like surfactants, friction reducers, and water repellents, dirt and oil repellents. So when these polyfluoroalkyl substances are used in this matter, so we must know that these PFAS are extremely hazardous to human health, and they are extremely stable, and due to their extreme stability, they easily persist or accumulates and moves in the environment. And the persistence of these chemicals or accumulation of these chemicals in the environment leading to severe toxic effects to human health. But still, the issue is we are not completely aware about the toxicological profile of these chemicals. But to certain extent, as we are all are familiar that halogenating agents or the compounds which contains halogens, they are normally not considered as a safer chemicals. And these are the polyfluoroalkyl substances, means there are more number of fluorine groups attached to these compounds. And as there are, as we know, fluorine is one of the most reactive element. And when such a elements enters or such a compounds enters into the atmosphere, and due to their stability, they continuously accumulates in the atmosphere. They accumulates in the various water resources, they accumulates in the nature, everywhere. And this accumulation leads to the pollution of the water, leads to pollution of the environment. And due to such a pollutions, we face a lot of health issues. Thus, we need to find out what are the solutions then. Then we need to find out safer alternatives. Many experts are trying to find out some safer alternatives to replace these type of substances. And there is a need of policies for limiting the use of such a toxic PFAS. Policies are also required, because if our government not taking any issues regarding the limited use of such a toxic chemicals, then also common people cannot do anything. Means every almost most of the people trying to fulfill their needs by saving the money, but they are not thinking whether these chemicals are producing the waste, or whether these chemicals are toxic to our health, or whether these chemicals or substances are toxic to nature. We are not thinking about this. So there is a need to find out some safer alternatives by the various chemical industries as well as there are execution of some policies for the limited use of such a toxic chemicals. Then the fourth area, which is sustainable water resources. What do you mean by sustainable water resources, and what is the water sustainability? Water sustainability means the effective and holistic management of water resources. And most of the countries facing the issue of water sources, or because there are now multiple demands on water resources, which drive the need for sustainable, integrated and holistic water management. Because as there is an increase in the urbanization, increase in the industrialization, there is an increase in the demand of water resources, increase in the demand of potable water. What I said, potable water. So there is a water available on the earth, but out of that, most of the water is locked in the form of a sea. And whatever may be the water available as a potable water, and that water is very, very, very small. And due to the industrialization, due to the urbanization, there is a continuously increasing the demand of this potable water. And continuously we are removing the groundwater level, groundwater with greater extent, and due to which there is a decrease in the groundwater level. There is a decrease in the groundwater level as well as streams, and all these water resources are going down.
Workshop, I call it, sir.
So unsustainable groundwater use of what unsustainable groundwater use results in water level decline. As per my observation, or you are also observing from several years, that since last 20 to 20s, I know when I was in school, at that time water level is around 15 to 20 feet below the surface. But nowadays people are trying to at that ground level nowadays is reached around or below the 500 feet. So it is a very horrible conditions. Means if we are going for the drilling of bore wells, so before 20 years the bore wells are around 200 or 250 feet, maximum 300 feet. Now people are going in deep around 500 feet, 1000 feet, still they are not getting the potable, getting the water. Means there is a decline in the water level because we are using lot of water which is available as a potable water, or which is available as a groundwater on the earth. So to minimize this, or to achieve the sustainability of this water resources, or to increase the level of water level of this potable water, or water level this together, industry and energy accounts, so we can with the help of we all can able to contribute through the sustainable practices. So by water harvesting or less consumption of the water, we can easily able to increase that declined water level. Okay, so if we know, then that together with industry and energy, so for the purpose of industry and energy production, it accounts around 20% of water. Means there is a demand of industry as well as for the purpose of energy production, 20% water is required. Means out of the water available as a fresh water, out of that 20% water is used for the industrial processes as well as for the energy productions. So and day by day this need is continuously growing. As there is a growing the need of pharmaceuticals, as there is growing the need of energy, so there is a continuous use, or continuous increasing the use of these water resources. So we need to focus on the sustainable water resources. So from the industry point of view, how can we help in this regards? So as growing infrastructure, increasing the environmental regulations, and receiving water environment issues stem the need for advanced wastewater treatment processes across the world. So to minimize the that use of water from various industries, because industries requires much quantity of the water for their processes. So but after the completion of the process, so whatever may be the wastewater generated, that wastewater directly subjected to the some water resources available on the earth. So these water or this water which is generated from these industries is normally not a potable water. But in the future, we need to convert this water into the potable water by various use of various wastewater treatment technologies. And these wastewater treatment technologies must be sustainable. Means using the sustainable wastewater treatment technologies, we can able to decrease the demand of water from various pharmaceutical or chemical industries. Or we can, after treating this wastewater, we can able to use this water for various other purposes like agriculture or some other uses. But industries nowadays, as compared to the previous 10 to 20 years, nowadays industries are more focusing on the wastewater treatments or efficient wastewater treatments, because this waste water generated from the industries is responsible to pollute the environment, responsible to pollute the various water resources, and due to which they affect on the nutritional value of soil as well as the effects on the quality of the water, as well as the effects on the aquatic nature or aquatic animal life of aquatic animals which is present in the sea. Because at the end, the entire water or entire polluted waters in during the rainy season, it enters to the sea, and ultimately it affects on the quality of sea water level as well, and that will affect to the aquatic health. So every day the industries are trying to develop some new technologies for the treatment of wastewater generated, and as continuously the regulations, environmental regulations are also become strict, more and more strict, and due to which there is a compulsion to the chemical industries to treat that wastewater efficiently, or remove almost or recover the most of the chemicals from that wastewater, recover the most of the toxic substances from that wastewater, and try to reuse such a water which is recovered from the various resources, and that will lead to decrease in the demand of potable water for the industrial use. Then one most important point which you need to focus, that we need to focus on the closing the loop. What do you mean by the closing the loop? So we need to design such a processes through which whatever may be the side product generated, or whatever may be the end product generated, these end products might be utilized somewhere into some other processes. So due to which there is no generation of waste. So whatever will be the waste generated, that could be used for the purpose of some, preparation of some other things. So the environmental sustainable recovery of sources from the waste is also the growing area of research. Means we need to recover the sources from waste, because many industries, or many industries after their production of the desired products, whatever may be the waste generated, that waste is directly dumped on the ground. So most of the times they are not utilized for the other purposes. So nowadays we need to focus on the recycling of this waste, or we need to focus on the recovery of the chemicals from the waste. No doubt there is a issue with cost efficiency during the process of recovery. But if we want to sustain our environment in the future, we must have to focus on the recovery of such a chemicals. And if we recover such a chemical, then we can able to close the loop. And ultimately, there is a less production of the waste from various chemical processes. And one of the biggest challenge nowadays is the plastic waste. And we all are familiar that the plastic waste is currently generated at a rate of around 400 metric tons per year. And as we are generating the waste of plastic waste around 400 metric ton per year, so difficulty of that with that waste is that waste continuously accumulating in the environment. And as there is a growing use of plastic, there is a growing accumulation, or there is a much more accumulation of this plastic waste into the atmosphere, and that may leads to some environmental hazards. And the amount of plastic accumulating in the environment is growing rapidly, and yet our understanding of its persistence is very limited. We are not clearly understand what happens with this plastic when we throw into the atmosphere. Even though we are saying we are developing some biodegradable plastics, biodegradable polymers, But still, there are the issues, like as I just said, the issues of cost efficiency. But in future, though there is a, there are the issues of cost efficiency, we need to focus on such a, areas where from where we can overcome these cost efficiency issues, and we will succeed in the developing the biodegradable plastics. So such a plastics can be easily reused, or they can be easily degrade with the help of some biological processes. Or we need to focus on the recycling of these plastics. So if we develop such a technologies through which if we are able to recycle that entire plastic waste, then we will succeed in the closing the loop. Then we can closing this cycle. Closing the loop means we need to close that cycle. So even whenever I ask the question to students, when we perform any preparation in the chemical laboratory, those who are belongs to post-graduation or UG students, when we perform any preparation, after the completion of this experiment, we got a very nice yield of the product. But what happened with that product after that completion of the practical? What happens with that product? We simply throw that product into the dustbins or into the waste collection vessel. How many times we try to reuse such chemicals for some other purposes? So in educational institutions also, we need to design such a practicals in which after completing one experiment, whatever may be the product obtained, that product could be used for the second experiment. Then whatever may be the product obtained from the second experiment, that could be used for the third experiment, fourth experiment, fifth experiment. And at the end, we achieve such a products. That product, again, we can use it for the next year students. So if we design such as looping experiments, then and then only we can able to close, or we can able to minimize whatever may be the waste accumulating in the atmosphere. But very few universities or very few institutions are focusing in this regards. Means there is a no proper direction to close such a loops or to design such a experiments which will help to minimize the waste from the chemical laboratories. And most of the chemical laboratories, whatever may be the waste generated in the chemical laboratory, that waste, as per my knowledge, most of the times not treated as well as not recycled. So it directly subjected into the sink, and it enters through the sink to various water resources, and that helps to pollute the nearby atmosphere. So we need to focus on the closing the loop, or design such a processes which are dependent on each other, and that ultimately leads to minimize the waste generated, or we can able to recover the various precious chemicals or various chemicals from the waste generated. Recently, this Sue and Scott et al., these researchers report benchmarks for degradation rates of common plastic. They have carried out the analysis, and they provided the benchmark for the degradation rates of common plastic. Means at what rate these different types of plastic undergo the degradation. Because for the degradation of the plastic needs several years. And this benchmark will help prioritize our future research on chemical degradation to close the loop. So on the basis of such using these benchmarks, we can able to prioritize which plastics we can extend in the future, and which plastics which are not degrading in the near several years, or it retains in the atmosphere for several years, then we can try to avoid the use of such undegradable plastics. or we can able to recycle such a plastics for different purposes, and then only we can able to close the loop of such a processes or such a accumulations. So still a lot of research is going on in this area. Many people are working. We got certain success, but we need more success in the future as well. Similarly, there is a growing demand of batteries we are using, as there is an increase in the number of vehicles, increase in the number of increase in the good infrastructure. So there is a demand of increased demand of batteries. And due to this increased demand of batteries, there is a great issue of recovery of the toxic metals present in these batteries, like lithium. So we are using, focusing on the mobile phones. So most of the peoples having the mobile phones. So we are normally addict of these mobile phones. And so every electronic industries, so there is a great advancements in the field of electronic industries, and there is a demand of this lithium based batteries. If you check your battery, then this battery is made from lithium ion polymers. So this lithium, which is present in these spent batteries, so this recovery of this lithium from the spent, though there is a very small quantity of the lithium is present. But if every year we everywhere there is a generation of electronic waste in several metric tons. So through that electronic waste, and or in that electronic waste, there is a presence of these type of batteries. So what to do with these batteries or these spent batteries, or how to or when these batteries enters into the atmosphere, or when it's thrown somewhere in the atmosphere, so through that this lithium enters into the atmosphere, which is a toxic element or which causes the health hazards. So we need to focus on the recycling of this. But as we going ahead, there is a increased use of mobile phones. There is an increased use of vehicles. So as there are mobile phones, as we are increasingly using the automobiles, or increasingly use of vehicles. So every both vehicles as well as mobile phones requires batteries. So specifically in the electronic field, if we are using mobiles, laptops, computers, so all these needs batteries. So after their use, or after when these mobile phones are getting dead, what will happen with that? We simply thrown that spent batteries or spent mobiles into the garbage. So that will also lead to create the pollution. So we need to focus some green methods to recover the toxic elements from such a spent battery. So this Lee and Etel group reported acid-free mechanochemical process for the recovery of lithium from the spent batteries, and that utilizes the salt and sodium carbonate as the sole reagent. So this reactions involve the isomorphic substitution of lithium by sodium, and it helps to minimize or recover the lithium present in such a spent batteries very easily. Though at present these methods might facing the issues of cost efficiency, but in future there might be the scope for the developments, and if we are succeed in that, then we can easily able to close this loop. Means as these batteries are continuously accumulating in the atmosphere, nobody is trying to recycle that batteries, or nobody is trying to recycle such a chemical, toxic chemicals present in the batteries. And the another issue is a continuous evolution of carbon dioxide. So we need to design such a capture and conversion methods of carbon dioxide. And if we are able to design such a capture and conversion methods of the carbon dioxide, then very easily we can able to achieve, or we can able to help to minimize some negative effects of these greenhouse gases, or we can able to help in the, or contribute in the environmental sustainability. So we need to focus on such a loop closing issues. So whenever we succeed in these type of issues with the help of the green chemistry, then and then only our future will be sustainable. So now we come to the our last point of this theme, that what future research needs in developing a circular economy. What our future needs, or what the future research needs. So we develop or contributed to certain extent in the designing of greener technologies, greener processes, and which will ultimately helping to sustain the environment or sustain our future. But still lot of work we have to carry out. So still there are some areas which might remain untouched, or very little touch is there, that will require further emphasis in order to strategically advance the field of green chemistry towards the applications that facilitate the circularity. Okay, so still there are some areas. What are these areas? What are these issues? Or what are these areas which we call it is need to be focused are depolymerization and defunctionalization methods for existing chemicals that can allow circularity, especially for plastics. So we need to focus on the depolymerization processes and defunctionalization methods for the existing chemicals. If we succeed in the depolymerization processes, then very easily we can able to get rid from these issues of plastic waste. But very little success up till now we achieved. Many peoples in the entire globe are focusing on the these issues like depolymerization and defunctionalization of different chemicals. And if we succeed in the depolymerization and defunctionalization, we can able to use or convert these chemicals into like plastics into the again in the form of monomers, and these monomers can be again used for the purpose of the synthesis of new polymers. Then another issue or another area is design of circular systems with consideration of human health and ecotoxicity, ideally via rational design of benign commodity chemicals. So we need to focus, or we need to consider human health and ecotoxicity or environmental toxicity by designing such a benign or safer or greener routes for the commodity chemicals. Because we everyday needs a lot of chemicals. Just example, in our home we are using a lot of chemicals. Nowadays we are using the chemicals due to this COVID pandemics, where there is a consumption of hand wash is greatly increased. And in a day, every people using much quantity of the such type of chemicals, or floor cleaning, or all household uses, we can use different chemicals. These are the commodity chemicals. And if we we are using some soaps for the bath, or as well as for the cleaning of the clothes. So whatever be the waste generated from such a sources, or for the preparation of these commodity chemicals, many industries are trying to use some safer processes, or industries need to focus on the benign, or benign means or the green chemistry, or safer methods, safer processes for the production of this type of chemical commodity chemicals. Then and then only we can able to minimize our health hazards as well as hazards to the our ecosystem. Then another area which includes is systematic application of life cycle analysis or thinking and process metrics in developing new manufacturing and synthetic routes. systematic application of life cycle analysis. We need to carry out the life cycle analysis. So we need to change our thinking and process matrix while developing the new manufacturing processes or synthetic routes for the various pharmaceuticals or chemicals. Then last is the implementation of machine learning and other big data methods to drive innovation towards new paradigms of circularity. So implementation of machine learning. We need to focus on the implementation of the machine learning or other big data methods to drive innovations towards the paradigm of the circularity. So we need to focus on these various areas and which will help us to achieve the goal of our sustainable future. Then question arises in a common question normally arises in our mind is after doing all those things, some common people have questions in their mind. Has the green chemistry a significant impact in the pharmaceutical industry? Has actually this green chemistry has a significant impact in the pharmaceutical industry? So the answer is yes. The new methods of green chemistry have positive results in the pharmaceutical industry because their R&D investments is very robust and can cover research expenses and support innovative ideas. Many R&D units, R&D units of many industries are investing on the green technologies or green processes. And so whenever we are thinking about the research and development, so the results came after several years. So we are in the process and we will get the results after some several years later. So, because many of the pharmaceutical industries are trying to apply the green chemistry methods by taking the initiative towards the sustainable environment or due to the regulations which are made by the government in strengthening the or in acquiring the environmental sustainability. Because of these points, these industries or pharmaceutical industries are significantly contributing in this area. Then by applying green chemistry methods, the pharmaceutical industries have better efficiency and lower cost for their operations, lower solvent use, lower less waste, and improvement in the green credentials of the industry. If the industry focuses on the use of less toxic solvents, or if the industries are focusing on the better efficiency, then ultimately that leads to lower the cost which is involved in the waste management. Because many industries, many pharmaceutical industries, they are focusing or they are utilizing their much money on the waste management or waste disposal or waste treatments. If they design such a methods through which we almost negligent quantity of the waste is generated, means ultimately they save their money which is spending on the waste generation. And ultimately, which will helps to improve the green credentials of all those pharmaceutical industries. Then scientists believe that the green chemistry is going to transform the pharmaceutical industry and drug manufacturing in the future. Scientists believe that the green chemistry is going to transform the pharmaceutical industry and drug manufacturing in the future. So in future, again, there are some advancements in the field of green chemistry, or many industry, pharmaceutical industries will continuously becoming greener and greener and greener because they are practicing most greener technologies, greener principles or greener processes, and that ultimately helps to reduce their efforts as well as helps to reduce the energy as well as helps to reduce the cost of all operations. So the question is yes, after that, what we expect from the field of education. So the education field is very much important, because nowadays also many people are not aware about the effective use of the green chemistry or effective use of the green chemistry, or many people are not aware of what do you mean by the green chemistry, what exactly it is applicable, or how it is applicable. So education and training. So our we all peoples are able to contribute in this aspect. So there is a need of contact based long and short courses and master classes. New short term courses needs to be based on the green chemistry techniques or green chemistry practices, and we need to popularize these things among the students, so students can easily take part in these type of courses, or they can easily take part in these type of classes. Then accordingly, we need to improve the supported e-learning system through which we can able to educate the peoples regarding the green chemistry practices, as well as full-time or part-time certificate, diplomas and degree options, including MSc in green chemistry and sustainable industrial technology. Nowadays also, though this term is coined after 20 years, before 20 years back, still there are very few institutions have the courses like diplomas or degrees, as well as MSc in green chemistry and sustainable industrial chemistry. There are courses of industrial chemistry, there are the courses of organic chemistry, physical chemistry, analytical chemistry, but very few institutions have the courses like MSc in green chemistry, MSc in green technology, or MSc in green and sustainable technology. So we need to promote. We are as a education field is one of the most important field through which we can promote the use of this greener technologies or greener approaches among the community. If we educate the peoples in these directions, then and then only these peoples will help us to improve the sustainability. Okay, so we need to better prepare the next generation and retain the existing man force in the principles and practices of green chemistry. So if we educate the peoples, if we educate the next generation, or if we educate the existing workforce or existing manpower regarding the principles and practices of green chemistry, this will definitely help us to improve the sustainability of our future, because that's why I said green chemistry is a basis for our sustainable future. If you are reluctant to educating the people, if you are reluctant to design such a courses, then it is quite difficult to achieve our target or achieve our goal in a stipulated span of time. If we want to achieve this goal in a short span of time, then we must have to educate the peoples. Alone, a single people cannot able to do anything else. But if we educate the multiple peoples, or if we educate many generations, then we can able to achieve this type of goals very easily. So availability of educational resources. What are the resources which are available, which will help us to educate the peoples? So one of the main problems teachers and students are likely to encounter when they are introduced to green chemistry is lack of educational resources to facilitate teaching and learning. So we both, teachers as well as students, likely to encounter the issue of lack of educational resources. So we need to improve the educational resources, and these educational resources based on the green technologies, green capacities, which are easily accessible to the students, which are easily accessible to the chemistries, then and then only we can able to literate the peoples with this aspect. And through such a resources are becoming more abundant and readily available for undergraduates, graduates, researchers, students, and teachers, and maybe many times are not aware about it. So some resources which are available, but even the students are not aware about it. So we must have to provide, readily have to make available all these resources related to the green chemistry practices to undergraduates or postgraduates and many research students pursuing their PhDs, as well as teachers as well. So because if the teachers are not aware about these practices, then they're not able to, they're not ready to think in the inclusion of syllabus relevant to the green chemistry in various branches. So we need to incorporate all those things in our educational scheme as well. So in this regards, that higher education sector also trying to incorporate many programs like master training courses, and there are so many number of PhDs are producing worldwide, which PhD students are working on the green chemistry practices. Major education initiatives are taken by the higher education sector. UG courses modules, they are trying to develop some UG course practicals, UG course case studies. And they are trying to even include this green chemistry as a subject in pre-18 education, along with the education, university education, as well as industry and society. But this is just a beginning, and more efforts needs to be taken in this regards. So higher education field or higher education sectors needs to focus more in these aspects. Then what's lacking in green and sustainable chemistry teaching? What exactly lacking nowadays? We are many times through this such a webinars or such a workshops, we trying to educate the peoples for the green chemistry technologies and how these green chemistry technologies are help us to sustain our future, sustain our environment. But what is lacking exactly in green and sustainable chemistry teaching? The lacking, what's the points which are lacking? Our UG syllabus content is normally patchy, which is not sometimes not appropriately managed. So patchy syllabus content is there. Few examples of structured teaching throughout UG courses. Only few examples of structured teaching throughout the UG courses. Lack of purpose designed practicals and workshop. There is a lack of purpose designed practicals. So we need to design practicals based on specific purpose, based on the purpose of averring environmental sustainability, averring the green chemistry practices, and failure by academics to use some of many good case studies. So very few case studies are there in our UG and PG syllabus. If we include since last few years, we are trying to include some case studies in relevance to the syllabus. But again, there is a need of increasing the inclusion of this different case studies through which the peoples can easily able to understand the importance of such issues. Then most important thing is, what are the barriers to green and sustainable chemistry teaching? What are the exactly barriers which are present? So barriers are the difficulties of introducing new core material. As we all are, as a teacher community, we all are familiar that we are not able, we don't have a right to modify or to improve or to revise our syllabus to certain extent. We just have to follow the UGC guidelines. So as a own, if I want to focus on the green or sustainable chemistry practices in the syllabus, if you want to include such a practice, then there are some difficulties introducing the new core materials. Lack of strong advocates of green chemistry. This is the most important thing. Means many people are not aware what is green chemistry and how green chemistry supports to the sustaining our environment or sustaining the pharmaceutical industry. Strong advocates, so they will easily what we say, and they will easily educate the peoples the use of this green chemistry practicals. Then tendency to modularize the material. We need to modularize the materials based upon the green chemistry practices. Preparation that green chemistry opposes, perception that green chemistry opposes other chemistry. There is a perception that some people may thought the green chemistry opposes to other branches of chemistry, or if we focus on the green chemistry, the importance of some other branches might be less. So this actually not happens, because all these branches of the chemistry are interlinked with each other. So focusing on one branch, that not means that we are opposing to the other branches. So this perception we need to change. This is a major barrier. Perception that green chemistry is a fad. This is another important barrier. Many people thought, yeah, green chemistry is a fad. So not green chemistry practices are useful for industrial scales. This perception of the peoples, they are thinking that green chemistry is a fad, is again the major barrier to the green and sustainable chemistry teaching. So we need to remove such a perceptions. We need to change our perceptions, and then only we can able to teach the green chemistry to the students with appropriate way. So these are the various barriers. So at the end, I just show you few pictures. This pictures will give you idea why we reached at this stage now. Because in the past, when the chemical industries just started growing, so at that time they are not aware about the utilizations of green chemistry practices. So this was the picture of the chemical industries in the past. Means there is no any provision for the environmental protection. There is no provision for the wastewater treatment. There was no provision for the environmental sustainability. So they are just focusing on the erection of the plants. This is the picture which represents our past chemical industry. So this picture, nowadays there are increase in the focus about the sustainable practices, increase in the focus about the minimizing the waste generated from the industries, minimizing the use of some safer practices, the use of wastewater treatments. Because of that, we are now in this situation or in this condition or in this stage. So this is the picture which represents the chemical industry today. But we need to improve these conditions more. Means in the future, our chemical industries must be more greener and greener. Our industry practices are more greener and greener. So because of that, whatever may be the hazard due to these chemical industries or pharmaceutical industries or waste generated from these industries, that hazard is almost minimized, and we can able to sustain the future of our coming generations. Okay, so if we follow all these type of practices, if we inculcate the skills among the coming generations, or we make aware the coming generations regarding the practices or principles of the green chemistry, then in the future definitely we can able to achieve the sustainability, or we can able to sustain the future of our coming generation. So, okay, that's all about the my today's talk. So I try to deliver my small knowledge in front of you as much as possible. So if you have any queries, then please feel free to ask. I will try to.
If anybody have any question, they may raise their hands. Sir, there are some questions in the chat box. On behalf of the participant, I am going to ask you, sir. Yes, sir. From Koji asked, what are the contribution of green chemistry in nanotechnology?
Contribution of green chemistry in nanotechnology. So, if you are many people are working in the field of nanotechnology because in the field of nanotechnology, many people are diverting towards particles or nano chemicals or nano particles from various natural resources. So, as there is a greater demand of electronics, this field of nanotechnology is also very much flourished. So, in the entire world, many people are working in the field of nanotechnology. And you might aware that in India, especially among all the Indian universities, here the near to us, the Shivaji University is mainly focuses on various greener techniques in the use or in the preparation or in the development of various nanomaterials. So, use of these nanomaterials or the development of these improvements of these nanotechnologies in the field of nanochemistry is much more. So, many people are throughout the world working in this area. But specifically in India, there is a less focus because India is not greatly focusing on electronic industry, because electronic industries are mainly located in the South Korea, Taiwan, Japan. So these are the leading countries where there is a great use of nanotechnology or nanomaterials. And due to the improvements in the nanomaterials, we are day by day decreasing the size of our electronic devices. That is the development which is occurred in the nanochemistry. Sir, your mic is off. Please switch your.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Sir, Devalina Netti from Mysore, Bhopal, she is asking about the software are used for the toxicological study. Which software are used for the toxicological study?
Toxicological studies. Nowadays, exactly, I can't able to give you the exact names of these softwares. But in the field of biochemistry, the peoples are trying to use many softwares which will give us in the field of, as like in the field of chemistry, we're using some softwares for the docking purposes. They will help us to predict the structure of possible active molecules. Similarly, there are some softwares which are available. Exactly, I'm not able to give you the names here, but if I get the names, I will get back to you. So many softwares which are available, they will just compare the existing toxic molecules or structures of the existing toxic molecules with the molecules which we are wanting to, which we want to design in the future. So if we have the similarity of such a molecules with previous toxic molecules, then we can able to change their structures, or we can able to change their framework. So, due to which the toxicity level of such a molecules can be minimized. Okay. Hello.
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Yes. So, at present, I can't able to give you the names exactly, but I will give. You be in touch with me. I will give you some names of the
sure,
software.
Sir, one more last question.
Yes.
Asking by Shalini Pal, what will be the green replacement of pesticides?
presently, many people are trying to design the pesticides based upon the renewable resources. Means the pesticides based on some plants or plant-based extracts. These plant-based extracts can also be used as a pesticides. But the issue is that availability is more, but the cost efficiency is quite the question. But as we go ahead, these cost efficiency issues also we can able to easily minimize. And many industries nowadays, many pesticide producing industries nowadays focusing on the use of some pesticides from the renewable resources. So pesticides either from some grasses which are toxic to some pest or some insects. So we are extracting such a grasses or extracting such a plants, and we can using it as a pesticides in the, but there is some limitation. So in future we will try to enhance or improve these technologies or improve these practices for the use of pesticides. So many natural pesticides are there which are available in the market, but the utilization is quite limited of such a pesticides.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving a valuable insights on the green chemistry, their application in future. Sir, I'm sure your address will help a lot of understanding to the core green chemistry. Request Dr. A.G. Vildar, sir, to conclude the session. Dr. A.G. Vildar, sir.
Thank you, sir. I would like to take the opportunity to extend our sincere gratitude to Dr. Chauhan sir for his beautiful session. We hope this session will be more fruitful. It was nice to listen Dr. Hemant Chauhan sir. One could simply understood the depth and discussion of Dr. Chauhan sir in the field of green chemistry for his presentation and soft discussion. His way of presenting the relevant issues and solutions by the approach of green chemistry method is greatly admirable. I wish great success for his future research work. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you again, sir. Now I request my colleague, Professor Hari Patel, to express vote of thanks.
Thank you, Milind sir. On behalf of Department of Chemistry, I am here to express sincere gratitude towards the chief guest speakers, Dr. Sushil Ghumre and Dr. Hemant V. Chauhan, for their valuable presentation regarding the sustainable future in the view of green chemistry. We are very much fortunate to have both distant speakers due to this pandemic situation, because this was not easily possible to attend such kind of workshops on offline mode from such peoples which are far away from us. Dr. Sushil Ghumre has presented and expresses their views related to green methods with suitable examples and which includes different name reactions. His presentation was very peaceful and easy to understand. Then we talk about Dr. Hemant Chauhan sir, who has discussed his views in the rhythmic presentation and discussion manner, which made the session very much interesting. We are very much thankful for both of the speakers who have found time to share with us for sharing important views over the environment-friendly green chemical solutions to overcome the challenges related to hazardous waste, which are producing during the synthesis of number of organic compounds. And the research area which was discussed by both of the speakers and their own contributions. We are highly inspired from their own contributions related to the green chemistry. We expect same cooperation in future from both of the speakers, and we are very much thankful for their presence and being the part of this workshop. Thank you very much, sir. We are also thankful to Dean of Faculty of Science and Technology, KBC NMU Jalgaon, Professor R.S. Patil, who is our principal, for his valuable guidance and consistent support. And on behalf of the Department of Chemistry, with kind permission of convener, Dr. U.M. Jadhav, I declare the national webinar on green chemistry for sustainable solutions is over here. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Professor Arun Patil, sir. Thank you, Hemant Jawan, sir. And thank you, Dr. Sushil Kumre, sir. Thank you, all the participants.
Thank you very much, sir.